in why we left our country in search of this adventure?
Not adventure, revenge.
Revenge. Now we face madness and misfortune, roaming through these towering mountains with a tempest in our wake, and you dressed as a man.
Cruel land. You receive me as a stranger, and as a stranger you inscribe my name with blood on your sand.
Say two strangers, my lady. It's two of us who left our country, two of us who roam through these arid fields.
Who could ever believe such strange events? But if I am not mistaken, Clarine, and I am not being deceived by my eyes, I believe I see a building.
I see it too, or it may be wishful thinking on our part.
It's such a small structure, cradled between the rocks, that it seems to be a part of the landscape.
Well, let's get closer. We've stared long enough. We can only hope those who live in it are hospitable enough to welcome us inside.
The door is open.
Oh. Heavens. What's that I hear?
I turn into a melting statue of fire and ice.
What is that strange sound? Maybe hate, but that's not the sound of a spirit in torment.
Oh, misery.
With a sad voice. I fear new trials and tribulations come our way.
Fear is already here, my lady. Lady?
Let's run from this awful place.
I don't think I have the strength to go anywhere.
Not a lamp. That feeble exhalation of light makes this place look more somber. I can see it's a prison, the tomb of a living corpse, chained like an animal whose only companion is a dim light.
Oh, misery! How can I hasten the heaven's answers? What crime have I committed in being born? If being born is man's greatest crime, then why do I alone bear the weight of this punishment? But isn't every living creature born? And what freedom do they possess that's been denied me? What greater offense have I caused to deserve this crueler penalty? The bird is born and given wings to flee the sheltering trees and become a flower in the winds. And I, who has more soul, must have less liberty. The beast is born, and nature proves a skillful hand in creating a strong and mighty form. But wretched is that beast, since it hunts, and it is hunted in a crude and endless labyrinth. And I, with finer instincts than a beast, must have less liberty. The river is born, it begins to stream, and offers such sweet music to every flower and blade of grass that grants the flow of its course. And I, with far more life, must have less liberty. Tell me! What justice, reason, or law can deny man these simple rights, these fundamental exemptions which God grants a stream, a beast, and a bird? Isn't every living creature born?
His words have left fear and pity in me.
Who has listened to my voice? Is it Crotado?
Tell him yes!
It's only a sad echo. A cry of pain lost within these cold walls that overheard your melancholy.
Since you've witnessed my weakness, I'll destroy you with my strong arms.
I'm dead, man! Forward!
If you were born a human, it is enough for you to spare me.
Fills me with kindness. Your presence prevents my actions, and somehow I feel something I've never felt before. Who are you? I ask because I know so little of this world. This place has been my cradle and my grave. Since the day of my birth, if you call it birth, I've only known this rustic desert. I live a miserable life. A living skeleton, like an animated corpse. I've only met one man who knows of my despair and has taught me all I know about the earth and sky. You might call me a human monster, since I am a man among beasts and a beast among men. And yet, amidst all this misfortune, I've studied human laws. Instructed from beasts and by the birds, I've learned to measure the distance between the gentle stars. Now you have calmed my anger, brought wonder to my eyes, and your soft voice has brought a calmness to my ears. The more I look at you, the more I like to admire and contemplate your beauty, for I feel a thirst in my eyes that not even death will be able to quench. Because if drinking is death, then my eyes will long to drink all the more. And if seeing is dying, then I'm dying to see.
I might seem astonished, but I'm quite moved by your words. And I don't know what to ask or how to respond. I can only say that heaven must have guided me here, for I have found comfort. The comfort can be found in someone sadder than oneself. There's a story of a wise man who was so poor that herbs were his only source of food. And one day he asked, can there be another soul who's as poor and miserable as me? And when he looked behind him, he saw another man who had gathered the leaves he had discarded. I lived my life, lamenting my misfortune, wondering if others suffered my curse of fate. But now, as I listen to your words, I realize my sorrows amount to nothing compared to your pain. If I may offer this consolation, listen to my heartache. Listen to what my sorrows have to say.
Lord of this tower, you coward! Have you fallen asleep and let your people enter this prison?
Now I'm confused.
That is Clotaldo, my jailer.
Come! Don't allow them to resist! Arrest them! Or kill them!
Guards of this tower, he is offering a choice. To capture us would be better.
Cover your faces as a precaution. No one should see us. You have trespassed the bounds and limits of these grounds, violated the king's orders, which prohibit anyone from visiting the prisoner.
There is no end to my despair.
Surrender! Hand me your weapons! Or these metal vipers will spit their poisonous bullets and break the silence of these walls.
You tyrant!
I swear, I shall set myself free of these chains by taking my own life before you try to offend and injure them. I'll tear myself apart with my own hands and teeth before I consent to your cruel ways and have to mourn their pain.
You know well that God's decree condemned you to death before you were born. Guards,
sir!
Lock the doors of this cell.
I don't blame you for denying me freedom, for I would piece together mountain and make a stairway of stone. And I'd appear before you like a warrior, shattering the glass that separates heaven and earth.
Perhaps it's to prevent you that you're bound to your misery.
I can see that pride offends you. Then allow me to beg for my life as I fall to your feet and express my humility. For it would be cruel if neither pride nor humbleness found favor in your room.
And if pride and humility don't impress you, then I, neither humble nor proud, but a mixture of both, implore you to save us and protect us.
Attention!
Sir!
Take their weapons and blindfold them.
I place my sword in your hands. You are the noblest, and it will refuse to be in the hands of someone of less nobility.
Mine is less demanding, so I'll hand it to one of your guards.
If I have to die, I want to leave it with you.
Where did you get this sword?
I brought this sword here to avenge my grief and misery.
Who gave it to you?
A woman.
What is her name?
I'm not supposed to reveal her name. Please, guard it with esteem for the sake of the man who wore it long ago.
But what do you know about this sword?
I can only tell you that it possesses a secret, a mystery. The one who gave it to me told me to travel to this land. She said, display your sword with skill and grace, you can prove to noblemen you're one of them. She told me there would be one man who, upon seeing my sword, would provide me with shelter and become my benefactor. She refused to tell me his name.
Heavens, help me. What is this I hear? This is the sword I left with beautiful Violante. And I promised her that whoever she sends my way, armed with this sword, will find in me a gentle father's love. But what fatherly love can I give him when he who brings the sword to win my favor has placed it in my hands and kneeled before me to meet his death? What am I to do when his appearance and all the signs coincide to meet the rumors of my heart? What am I to do, since seeing him, my heart has become a caged bird that beats against my chest, only to find escape through tears that burst open the windows of my eyes? What am I to do? Heaven, help me! But why do I have doubts? Why do I let self-love and loyalty disarm me? To take him to the king is to take him to his death, but if I hide it from the king, I disobey the laws of fealty. What I must do is present myself before the king and tell him that he's my son, and that he could kill my only son, perhaps by proving my loyalty, the king will show his mercy and save his life. But if the king in his unyielding cruelty deals him death, he will die without ever knowing I'm his father. Come then, strangers, and don't fear if you're not alone in your misfortunes. For in times of uncertainty, I don't know if it's better to live or to die. Say that braves of banished comets and a burst of music greets your presence. A symphony of fountains announces your arrival, as if welcoming the goddess of spring. Bullets shoot into the air as if greeting the goddess of war. Birds welcome you with gladness after a bachelor life, and greet you as if with the goddess of dawn, the goddess of my soul.
It is unwise for you to flatter me with praise, since your words do not match your actions. And your fine compliments seem to contradict everything I see before me. If your sweet words are preparing for war, let me warn you that I'm armed for the battle. For it is base to flatter with the tongue and wish evil with the heart.
You are quite misinformed, Estrella. You doubt my honest compliments. I beg you to listen to what I have to say. When the last king died, he left Basilio to inherit the throne and two daughters, one who was your mother, and the other one mine, two sisters who may both rest in peace. As for Basilio, our present king, who was old and each day fading more with age, he was always more interested in study than in women. He was left a widower, and we both aspire to his throne.
Yes, and I am the daughter of the elder sister.
I am the male child of the younger sister, and I ought to be preferred over you.
But you weren't born in this country, and you're the ruler of another kingdom.
I do not intend to make war on you, Estrella, so you can declare war on me. We can both express our intentions to our uncle when he meets us here today. Oh, may the common people, the only true astrologer, may they crown you queen, the loving queen of my choice, and may love that wise God grant you the kingdom of my heart.
My breast can hardly contain such courtly generosity, since I wish the imperial monarchy were mine so I could pass it on to you. And yet, my love is displeased by your infidelity, by the portrait of a girl you carry close to your chest.
We read the arrival of the king to notice our conversation.
Your Highness!
Your Excellency!
Your Eminence, I am filled with gladness.
Your Holiness, I bow before you with
great
joy.
Great king, allow me to.
Allow me to kiss your ring.
Your hand, my loving uncle.
My devoted uncle.
Beloved king, allow me
allow my arms to embrace you.
And kneel before you.
And kneel before you, my king.
Niece, nephew, rise. Rest assured that you will be treated as equals, since you are both loyal to my commands and have come here so affectionately. You already know that through my studies in science, I have obtained great recognition and have earned my place in this world as a man of wisdom. You already know that the science I esteem and study the most is the subtle mathematics by which I can discern and chart the future events of ages to come, the science of racing against time, by which I can foretell the future and win men's gratitude by alerting them to the days that lie ahead of us. Those circles of snow, those transparent canopies illuminated by the sun and sliced by the moving moon, those astrological designs drawn by the stars, are the subject and the heart of my studies. The firmament is my book, a book drawn in stars, placed in vellum paper and in sapphire binding, in which all that is bound to happen, whether adverse or beneficent, is written in golden letters. A book I've learned to read with the speed of my own spirit, since events always seem eager to take their own path. I just wish that I'd been the victim of heaven's wrath long before I learned to read its messages and interpret its signs. For when a man is unfortunate, even his own merit can turn out to be a sharp knife and stabs him in the back. But let the events of my life explain all this far better than I, so that you may marvel at them. With Coraline, my wife, I had a son whose birth exhausted the sky of ill-fated omens. Even before he faced the light from the living grave of the womb, his mother dreamt of a monster in human form who ripped open her belly and, drenched in her own blood, was killing her. On the day of his birth, his zodiac sign was eclipsed by a great battle between the sun and the moon, in which the world was left blood-soaked, and the earth was shrouded in the darkest night since the death of Christ. Buildings shook, the clouds rained stones, and the rivers gushed with blood. It was under these dark and fatal signs Segismundo was born, announcing his true nature by killing his mother, and by this malice, saying, "I am a man, and I have begun to pay all kindness with evil." When I refer to my books, I found in them, and in all things, that Segismundo would be the cruelest of men, the most evil prince, and the most impious of all monarchs, who would destroy and divide his kingdom, a school of treachery, and an academy of vice, and that he, one day, carried away by his cruelty amidst his crimes and horrors, would try to trample me. It is with great anguish I admit it, for he's liable to make a carpet from the gray hairs of my beard. Who doesn't fear the coming harm? What man doesn't believe in the evil predicted to him by his own studies? So it was proclaimed that the prince had died at birth, and as a precaution, I built a tower hidden in the mountains where light could hardly find its way. There Segismundo lives to this day as a wretched and poor prisoner, for only Clotaldo has spoken to him and kept him company. He has taught him the sciences and the Catholic faith, being the only man who has had witness to his misery. There are three things to be considered here. The first is that I love my country, and I must do all within my power to rescue it from the oppression of a tyrannical king. Second is that to deprive my own flesh and blood of the rights he deserves by both human and divine law is against Christian principles, since no law says that to restrain another man from becoming an evil tyrant, I should become that way myself. And the third is the great error I might have committed in allowing myself to believe in the prediction of events, for even if his character is inclined towards violence and destruction, perhaps he'll not be easily swayed, since even the most evil omen, the most awful astrological sign, can but influence our free will, but not force us in any direction. And so, meditating on all this, I have come up with a solution that will stun you. Tomorrow, without letting him know that he is my son and your king, we shall place my son on the throne so that he may take command and govern you. And you will swear obedience. If he proves to be prudent, sane, and benign, then we'll know the star's predictions were inaccurate, and we'll benefit in having our rightful king. If he acts unjustly and cruelly, then I shall have to depose him and imprison him again. If the prince should be as I fear, my niece shall marry my nephew, and you will have a king and queen more worthy of the crown. This I order as your king, and I ask you as a father, and I beg you as an elder, as a man who trusted the stars.
I may offer my reply, as the person with most at stake. On behalf of all, I say, bring us Segismundo. It's enough that he is your son.
Give us our prince. We want him, if he's our rightful king.
I'm grateful for your kind words, and I will honor your request. Tomorrow you shall seek him.
Long
live the great king, Basilio! May I have a word with you?
Oh, Clotaldo! What can I do for you?
Seeing you, my king, always fills me with gladness, but today, a twist of fate has robbed me of that joy, since I bring troublesome news.
What troubles you, Clotaldo?
Sir, a misfortune has occurred.
Go on.
This young man, sir, he's entered the tower, and he has seen the prince. And
He's...
Don't worry if he's seen the prince. I have revealed the secret. We must have a conversation later, for you are to witness and preside over the greatest event in the history of the world. As for these two captives, rest assured I will not punish them for your carelessness. I forgive them. Let them go.
Great king, may you live 1,000 centuries. Blessed be God. Now I don't have to tell him he's my son. Strangers, you are at liberty.
I kissed your feet 1,000 times.
I would do the same, but you would probably agree that 1,000 kisses upon your feet is plenty.
I am indebted to you, sir. Since you granted me my life, I will forever be your faithful servant.
No, it was not your life that I gave you. A nobleman who's been dishonored has been erased from life, and since you've come here to avenge an offense, I haven't given you your life because you haven't found your rightful place in the world.
I confess that I barely exist. Even though you have granted me back what little seemed to be left of my life. But I promise I will take my revenge, and my honor will then be so spotless and clean that it will seem like an immaculate gift from you.
Then take this sword you brought with you. I trust that all it takes is just a few drops of your enemy's blood and the deed is done. I know so, for it was once my sword. I mean, just for the brief moment I had it in my keeping.
In your name, I put on this sword and swear a second time to obtain revenge no matter how mighty my enemy may be.
Is he very powerful?
So powerful I fear I will lose him as a friend if I tell you his name.
On the contrary, you find more of a friend in me because I tried to protect you and help you.
Because I wouldn't want you to think I mistrust you. I let you know that my enemy is no less than Astolfo.
Astolfo? I suggest that you leave this country and forget all this foolishness.
I can't help it. Even though he was my prince, what he did destroyed me.
Even if he had slapped you in the face.
God, what happened to me was far worse.
Tell me then, since nothing could be worse than what I can imagine.
If I were to tell you, I'm afraid I would lose your respect. If I were to tell you, I'm afraid I would lose your esteem and affection. And I don't know why, I can't put up the courage to tell you. These clothes, Clefellow, this disguise, I'm not who I appear to be. And let this be a hint. A soul who came to this country to marry Estrella, just imagine how offended I am. Arsena.
Wait, listen, come back. What confusion. What a labyrinth I find myself in without that fine string we leave behind us to find our way back out. My family's honor is destroyed. The enemy is powerful. I am a vassal. She's my daughter. Heavens, show me a path. Although, I doubt there's a way back out when the sky seems to be a dark omen. And the world, one great mystery.
And then, tell me what happened, Clotaldo.
Everything you commanded has been carried out. I followed your orders carefully. I gathered herbs that possessed sedative qualities, and I made a potion, a drink that deprives man of his ability to reason by robbing him temporarily of his inherent will. I gathered opium, henbane, and valerian, and as always, these medicinal herbs, which have the ability to transform a man into a living corpse, demonstrated their magical powers. I gave Segismundo the potion, and he fell into a deep sleep. But not before I reminded him of the silent wisdom of nature, and how the sky and the mountains have been his teachers, and how they taught him of the laws that govern the beasts and birds. And in order to elevate his spirit, knowing what you intend to do, sir, I let him imagine a mighty eagle, one which prefers the rising heights of the fires and comets instead of diving down towards the shallow gust of the worldly winds. I praised its bold flight by saying, after all,
You are the king of the birds, and you have the right to fly above them all. This prompted him to think of kingship, and inspired in him great thoughts of ambition and pride, since royal blood runs through his veins. But I could also detect rage in his voice as he said, I know that in the Republic of Birds there is a natural order, and some birds swear obedience to others, but I am not a bird, and I will never submit to another man's will. Seeing that this made him furious, since it's his constant turmoil, I gave him the potion, and as soon as he drank it, his strength surrendered to a deep sleep. A cold sweat came over him. He trembled so much that if I had not known these were the side effects of the drug, I would have feared for his life. But a few men came to take him away and brought him here to the palace and laid him on your bed, and there he sleeps until the drug loses its power.
This is all an experiment, Clotaldo. I wish to see whether it is possible to change fate, or whether man has the capacity to dominate and rule the stars. This is why we have brought him to the palace. We will test his ability by allowing him to rule.
May I ask, my lord, why we put him to sleep?
If he found out today that he is my son, and tomorrow saw himself reduced once again to prison and to misery, this would surely destroy him and leave him without any consolation. It would be better to make him think that everything he sees is nothing more than a dream. For in this world, Cataldo, all who live are dreams.
I hope you are not mistaken, my lord. But now it's too late. I believe he has awakened and he's coming our way.
I shouldn't be here. You're his tutor. You should guide him. He's probably confused. Tell him the truth.
So you give me permission to tell him?
Yes. Perhaps if he discovers the truth, he'll recognize his own danger and conquer himself.
Come to witness the celebrations, but it cost me 4 blows to get in. 4 times the guard at the door slapped me, 4 times he asked me for a permit or a pass. I told him I didn't need a written order to witness all the celebrations. My eyes are my paid seats. They're my tickets of admission. They're my windows, my balconies.
Here's Clarine, the servant of that misfortunate being who has brought to this country my disgrace. Clarine, what news do you have?
What news? Sir, you have advised Rosaura to dress as her own sex.
I believe it is the proper thing to do so as not to cause a scandal.
She's also changed her name, and she now seems to be your niece.
That's good news, isn't it?
Not necessarily for me. I'm left without a job since she's now residing in the palace and is the maid of honor of the extraordinary Princess Estrella.
We'll find something for you to do.
It would be better if you were to help Rosaura in other ways and help her find the man who's done her wrong.
All in due time, Clarine. Time will settle all accounts.
That's all I think about. Time. And time seems to be at a standstill for me, since I have no employment, and my lady is living in luxury like a queen, because everyone thinks she's your niece. Meanwhile, I, who traveled with her from afar, I'm starving to death and no one's paying any attention to me. And everyone forgets, I'm Clarine. And the name Clarine comes from Clarion, and Clarion means trumpet. And should I sound my trumpet, the king, Astolfo, and Estrella will immediately find out what's going on, for I can be both a loud trumpet and a servant, and neither is good with secrets.
I understand your concerns. For the time being, you can be my servant.
But here comes Segismundo.
Masters in his hall gave me news today. He brought from overseas, and never I you pray. No one, no one, no one, no one see me clear. Hope and our of hope on earth, born the son of God so dear. No one, no one, no one, no one see me now. God today I bore for praise and cast it down the proud.
I can't believe my eyes. I'm amazed by everything I see before me. Me in this majestic palace. Me wearing such fine clothes and surrounded by such elegant servants. Me waking up in such a soft bed. And so many people helping me to dress. To say I'm dreaming all this would be a mistake. Since everything is so real. I know I'm not dreaming. I'm not Segismundo.
God, tell me the truth. Why do I find myself here in this place? Why should I worry about these things when I should let myself be served?
He seems confused.
Who wouldn't be, considering all that's happened to him?
Me.
Should they sing another song?
Sweet rose in virtue and gentleness, the lily to every scene.
No, I don't want them to sing anymore.
We wanted to entertain you, since you seem so distressed.
Music doesn't really help.
Your Highness, great Lord, give me your hand to kiss. Allow me to have the honor to be the first to swear obedience to you as Lord.
Here's Clotaldo. How is it possible that the man who mistreated me in prison treats me now with such respect? Tell me what is happening to me.
Sir, I understand why you're so confused and full of doubts when your life has suddenly changed, but I will try to help you understand. Sir, you ought to know that you are the prince of this land, and you will inherit the throne. You have been kept from the palace because the stars foretold 1,000 disasters if you were crowned. But trusting in your ability to defeat these predictions, because fate can be controlled by your goodwill and actions, you have been brought to the palace while your soul surrendered to sleep. The king, your father, will visit you soon and he'll tell you the rest.
What else do I need to learn now that you have told me who I am? What else do I need to know to wield my power and pride from now on? How could you betray your country? How could you hide me and deny me my rightful place in the world? You traitor!
Sir!
You lied to the king, and you were cruel to me, and so the king, the law, and I condemn you to death. Oh, I killed you with my own hands. Nothing can stop me! And if you try, I'll throw you out of the window.
Clotaldo, run! Run!
You poor fool! You're already showing all your pride without even knowing you're dreaming all this!
Please, allow me to tell you.
Get out of here!
He was obeying the king's
orders. Then he was obeying an injustice.
He doesn't have the right to judge the king's orders.
I am his prince!
Sir, you must understand.
Are you his accomplice?
No,
then you shouldn't say a word.
The prince is right. Everything you said is wrong.
And who asked your opinion?
I did.
And who are you?
I'm just a fool. A dog who pokes his nose in all the wrong places.
Out of all the people I've met in this new world, you're the one I like the best.
Great Lord, pleasing to say his wonders of the world is my specialty.
Blessed be this joyful day, my friends. You fill the walls of this palace with splendor and light, as if with the glowing sun rising over the mountains. And though we crown you late in time, may the laurel wreath you wear stay fresh and green for as long as it took to crown you.
God save you.
You obviously don't know who I am, so I'll excuse you for not greeting me with a little more honor and respect. We are of equal rank. My name is Astolfo. I'm a birth of duke, and that makes me your cousin.
I said God save you, but maybe God isn't good enough for you since you're boasting about who you are. Next time we meet, I'll ask the devil to save you.
Your Highness should remember that Segismundo comes from the mountains and has his own way of dealing with people. I believe my Lord Astolfo expects...
I was quite annoyed by the way he came in here to make his speech and then he put on his hat.
He's a nobleman.
I'm nobler than he is.
Still, Your Highness, there should be more respect between...
And perhaps you should mind your own business.
May Your Highness be welcome to the palace.
It is your cousin. Her name is Estrella, like a star.
She should be called Sun instead of Star.
Welcome to the throne that receives you with gratitude and open arms. May you live for centuries to come.
Your presence is enough to make me feel welcome. May I ask, what work do you leave for the sun to do when you rise from your bed in the morning? Allow me to kiss your hand. Father was cruel. who have kept me from laying eyes on your face and on your soft, warm, sensual skin, since your beauty could make a dead man rise from the grave.
Perhaps it's better to be a little more discreet, Your Highness.
Sir, I advise you not to be so forward.
Didn't I tell you to mind your own business?
I'm only trying.
I'm not interested in what you have to say.
But I thought I heard you say that if something seems unjust.
And you also heard me say that I would throw anyone who annoys me out of the window.
Who in the world is this man?
Go help! Will someone go help?
Fell from the balcony into the sea.
You won't control your violent actions.
And you should be careful that you don't end up like him.
There's a great difference between a man and a beast. There's also a great difference between living in a remote mountain and a palace.
What just happened here?
Nothing. Someone made me very angry, so I threw him out of the window.
What? This is the king!
On your first day, you kill a servant?
He told me it couldn't be done, so I proved him wrong.
You devastate me with your violence. I was hoping you had the ability to conquer your fate, but it saddens me to see your first deed here is to commit a murder. How can I offer you my arms and embrace you when I know your hands are stained with human blood? Who can see a dagger covered in blood and not feel terror? Seeing your cruel hands keeps me from your arms because I can't imagine them wrapped around me in a loving embrace.
I don't need your embrace. I've lived without it all these years. Who would want the embrace of a father who mistreats his son? Why would I want a father who locks me in a tower and treats me like an animal, like a monster? How can I value your embrace if you have deprived me of human life?
I wish to God you had never been born, so I wouldn't have to hear your voice and live with such disgrace.
You did give me life, and then you denied me my rightful place in the world.
You were a poor and miserable prisoner, and now you're a prince. The least you can be is grateful.
Why should I be grateful when everything you're giving me is what I'm entitled to have by right of birth? I'm not indebted to you. If anything, you owe me for all the years you kept me from this world. All the years you robbed me of freedom, life, and honor. You're lucky I don't claim what you stole from me. You're the one who ought to be grateful!
You beast! You insolent, arrogant fool! The stars have fulfilled their prophecy. You're everything they predicted you to be. I suggest that you be humble and kind. Take heed. Tomorrow you may wake up and discover that this were all a dream.
No. No, I can't be dreaming all this. No, I'm not asleep. I can see and touch! I know who I was and who I am now. There's no turning back, Father. Even though you regret it, I know I am the prince and I will inherit your throne!
Of all things you've seen here in the world.
I think women are more beautiful than men. They seem to be a little bit of heaven on earth. Especially the one I see before me.
The prince is here. I'll go.
Stop, woman. Who are you? It seems as if I've seen you before.
I am just an unhappy woman waiting on Estrella.
Why must you serve Estrella when she seems to be but a faint star, one that depends on your light? How is that possible? In the realm of fragrances, the rose presides over other flowers, and in the Academy of Stones, the splendor of the diamond is the most desired. And if you look at the empire of the moving stars, you'll find that Venus is the favorite in the sky. Why must you serve a woman of lesser beauty when you are like Venus, like a diamond, like a rose?
I'm honored by your compliments. But let my silence be my response, since I lack words or reasoning to pour
Don't go. Why do you should leave me in the darkness?
Your Highness, I request your permission to go.
To leave in such haste is not asking for permission, but taking.
Your Highness! If you will not grant my request, then I will be forced to take it.
This force me to behave violently instead of courteously, since resistance is like a poison to my patience.
Even if this poison kills your patience and fills you with rage, I won't allow it to threaten me or force me to give in.
What seems impossible is always tempting. You're making me lose my fear of your beauty.
They were right to predict your cruelty and destruction on this kingdom. What else can they expect from a man born among wild beasts who has nothing human about him except his name?
I was courteous to you so I could win your affection, so you wouldn't insult me like this, but maybe it's better to be a monster. You then, get out! Leave us alone, lock the door, and don't let anyone enter!
You'll only find a dead woman!
Didn't you say I was a monster?
No!
Sir! Wait!
You feeble, crazy old man, how did you get in here?
Sir, listen to me. Take hold of yourself. My lord, listen to what I have to say. Today you may find yourself master of us all, but tomorrow it may turn out to be a dream.
One way of finding out if this is life or an illusion.
This is how I hope to save my life!
Let go!
I won't let go! Not until someone comes to restrain your anger and rage!
Let go! Let go, I say, let go or I'll kill you!
Someone help! I guess one of us can let go of Pablo!
Put your sword away!
Not until it is stained with this blood!
Is this how you want to stain your sword? With the cold blood of an old man?
He's a cruel old man.
Put your sword away. Spare him his life.
In exchange for yours, since you've insulted my pride.
This is self-defense.
Don't anger him!
What's happening here?
Nothing, my lord. A lot has happened here. I tried to kill this old man.
You have no respect for an old man?
My lord, it doesn't matter. It's only me.
At your age, you may also find yourself pleading for mercy at my feet, since I've been forgotten the cruel way you raised me.
Before that happens, you'll fall asleep again, and you'll believe that everything that has been happening to you was a dream.
Predictions never fail. The stars were accurate when they predicted Segismundo's crimes and cruelties. But, in my case, the stars were not so precise, since fate promised me triumph, good fortune, the beauty of your eyes, which compete with the glory of the sky.
Perhaps the stars have in store for you the eyes of the mysterious lady whose portrait you carry around your neck. I suggest you save your fine compliments for her. In affairs of the heart, my dear cousin, flatteries and vows meant for other women are nothing but empty words to me.
I promise to remove the portrait. I swear that you, and only you, will occupy my heart. For where there is a star, there is no room for shadow. And when that star is as bright as the sun, there is no place for darkness.
Nothing left to fear since my misfortunes have now reached their limit. My lady. Oh, Andrea. May I be of any service, my lady. I am so glad it's you who's followed me here.
for you are the only one to whom I'd entrust a secret.
You honor me, have my undivided attention.
Ever since I've known you, you've shown me your affection and gained my trust. Now, I'll tell you a secret, something that troubles me greatly.
As you wish, my lady.
My cousin Astolfo is to marry me, but an obstacle stands in the way. He carries the portrait of another lady. I have spoken to him about this, and he wishes to prove his love to me. Now he's gone to get it, and I'm afraid he will bring it here and hand it to me. So I want to ask you to receive it on my behalf. I'll say no more. You must know about matters of the heart.
How I wish I didn't know. Who can have the ability to counsel one's heart at a moment like this? Can there be anyone in the world attacked with more misfortunes and destroyed with more sorrows? What am I to do when there's no relief or consolation to be found? They say that misfortunes are cowards because they never travel on their own. I'm convinced they're brave, since they possess the intelligence and capacity to master the truths that charge forward with such great force. What will I do in such confusion?
My lady, here's the portrait.
Why do you seem so surprised, Your Highness? Why do you seem astonished?
I'm surprised to see you here, Rosaura.
Rosaura? You mistake me for some other lady. I am Andrea, a humble servant who doesn't wish to cause you any confusion.
I know you are Rosaura.
I don't understand, Your Highness.
Not with this pretense, Rosaura.
What do you mean, Your Highness?
The soul never lies, Rosaura. You present yourself as Andrea, but my heart tells me you are Rosaura.
Estrella ordered me here to ask to hand over the portrait to me on your behalf.
You don't fool me, Rosaura.
I am only waiting for you to give me that portrait.
Since you wish to continue this deception, Andrea, tell the princess that since I esteem her so, I will be delivering the portrait in flesh and blood, and you only have to show her your face.
And I'll be showing her the face of a woman you have destroyed. Now give me that portrait, you liar! You betrayed me.
If I don't give it to you?
Then I'll take it. Because I'm not leaving here until you give it to me.
Listen to me.
I would rather die than see it in that woman's hands.
You're mad.
And you have deceived me.
It's enough, my
Rosaura. I'm not your Rosaura. Now give me that portrait, you liar! You villain! Andrea!
Astolfo? What is this?
If you wish to know, I will tell you, my lady.
What do you intend to tell her?
You asked me here to wait for Astolfo and ask for a portrait that you wanted. As I waited for him, I remembered I had one of my own on the sleeve. So I amused myself by looking at my little portrait. When Astolfo came into the room, it fell from my hand onto the floor and he picked it up. But then he refused to return what belonged to me. I became angry and impatient and I tried to take it from him. That's my portrait he holds in his hand. I don't know what he intends to do with it, but I wish he would return it to me.
Astolfo, give me that portrait.
My lady.
Is it not my portrait?
I can see how it resembles you.
Well, since this is my picture, please ask him to give the other one you requested.
Here's your portrait. Leave us alone.
I have my portrait back. I don't care to know what happens next.
Even though I don't intend to see you or speak to you ever again, I wish to have the portrait I asked you for, since I so foolishly asked for it, and I don't want to leave it in your power.
Beautiful Estrella, I wish to serve you and obey you, but I can't give you the portrait you asked for. And that's simply because...
You are a low and crude man! I don't want any portrait from you, since it will only remind me of how foolish I was in asking you for it in the first place!
Stop! Let me explain! Damn you, yourself! Why did you come to this country to ruin me, and to ruin yourself?
This be me? Am I in chains again? Am I once more in prison? Am I back in my grave? Yes, God help me. All the things I dreamt.
Now it is my duty to deceive him. It's time to wake up.
Yes, it's time to wake up.
You must have slept from the time we were talking about the flying eagles until now. Have you slept all day?
Yes, and I'm probably still asleep. What I saw all around me was a dream. And what I see before me now must be part of another dream, since everything seems as clear and vivid as it was in my dream. But everything can be a dream.
Tell me what you dreamt about.
I can't describe it to you as a dream. I can only tell you what I saw with my own eyes. Perhaps it was all a lie, but I woke up in a bed made out of petals. It was so soft, it could have been woven by the flowers of spring. A thousand noblemen bowed down to me and called me their prince and offered me fine clothing and jewels. You were there, and when you noticed my state of confusion, you told me of my good fortune. I may appear to be in chains now, Clotaldo, but there I was a prince.
You must have given me a reward for the good news.
No. I called you a traitor and I tried to kill you.
You were so cruel to me.
I was the lord of all. And I wanted revenge for what was done to me. I felt love for one woman. Now everything is gone, and I still feel that love within me.
You dreamt of empires because we had a conversation of eagles. But even in dreams,
you should honor someone like me who raised you with such pain. Even in dreams, good deeds are never lost. And let me restrain my fury, my ambition, and my rage. Yes, I'll do that. Since life's so strange, and living seems like dreaming. The king dreams. He's king and lives and rules under this falsehood. And all the acclamations he receives are nothing but words that will later fade and turn to ashes scattered in the winds. And to think there are men who want to rule knowing that one day we must awaken from this sleep of death. The rich man dreams of gold coins and silver, but with that dream comes the burden and the worries of guarding his fortune. The poor man dreams his suffering, for the poor man has nothing but his misery and his poverty. We live and dream our reality until we waken from our sleep. The man who tries to get ahead in life is dreaming. The man who works and strives is dreaming. The man who hurts, offends, and wounds is dreaming. In this world, all men dream who they are. But no one understands this. I dream that I am imprisoned in this cell. And yet, I dreamt once before that I lived a better life. And what is life? An illusion. What is life? Frenzy. Shadow. Fiction. And our greatest good is but little. For all this life is a dream. And dreams are only dreams.
Custom in this kingdom? Take someone, maybe. make him prince and later lock him up again? And they seem to do this. I better play the part.
Lend us your feet!
I will not! For what good is a footless prince?
We all know it's your father. Only prince will recognize.
Were you disrespectful to my father, you scoundrels?
It was only out of loyalty.
If it was loyalty, I forgive you.
Come and restore your kingdom. Long live Segismundo!
Long live Segismundo!
Did you say Segismundo? This seems to be the name they call all their false princes.
Who is calling my name?
It's the end of my game, prince.
Who is Segismundo?
I am.
Then how dare you call yourself Segismundo?
You insolent fool! I never called myself Segismundo. You were the stubborn fools who Segismunded me.
Wants to deprive you of your throne and give it to Duke Astolfo. This is what he's announced to his court. But since the people have learned that they have a natural successor, they refuse to have a foreigner come and rule them.
So with good intentions, we've come to fight you. We've come to free you from this place where you've been unjustly kept as a prisoner. We bring weapons, and outside awaits an army that will declare war and fight your place as our sovereign leader.
Am I to dream again of great heights and power that will diminish time? Am I to witness another landscape of shadows that will soon vanish in the wind? Or should I risk being deceived by my own humble intuition, which we've learned to guard and protect? I won't allow it. I won't. I won't be misled by fate. I know that this life is a dream. I know you're just trying to deceive my dead senses, so go away, figments of my imagination. Voice without a body, body without a voice. I don't want false notions or imaginary power. I will not have illusions that dissolve at the slightest breath of dawn. Just like that young almond tree which unadvised rushes to bloom before its time and finds its flowers wilted before its spring. I know you. I know you well. I know you do the same to all who fall asleep. There's no use pretending. I know that this life is a dream.
If you think we're fooling you, look out and see what was once a desolate mountain is now filled with soldiers waiting to obey you.
I saw all that once before, just as clearly and distinctly as I see it now, and it was a dream.
Dreams always seem to foretell the future, and that was the meaning of your dream.
You're right. And in case what was foretold is accurate, and life seems as brief as a dream, let us dream again. Let us dream, but let us close our eyes and be attentive, knowing that we must awaken when the dream is full of pleasure, and we'll be able to laugh and be less deceived if we're warned against this harm. So by taking all precaution, and knowing that power is merely borrowed and must be returned to its owner, let us dare and risk everything. Soldiers! I thank you for your loyalty. You'll find in me a leader that will free you from foreign rule. Prepare for battle! I'll prove my courage. I'll declare war against my father and defeat him. Soon I'll see him kneeling at my feet.
Move it, Segismundo!
Heavens! What's all this commotion?
Othello.
Sir.
That'll throw him off the mountain.
I kneel before your feet. I know I shall die.
Get up. Get up from the ground. I need you as my guide. I need to trust you as one trusts his guiding star. For I know I owe my upbringing to your great loyalty. Embrace me.
What are you saying?
That I am dreaming. And I want to do good.
For even in dreams, good deeds are never lost.
Well, sire, if doing good is what you desire, then don't be offended if I must also do the same. This means I cannot counsel you. If you wish to make war on your father, my king, here I am at your feet. Kill me.
Clotaldo, I respect your decision. Now go and serve your king. We shall meet on the battlefield.
I'm grateful to you 1,000 times.
Don't let me open my eyes if I sleep. And if this is reality, don't let me close my eyes. Dream or reality, to do good is what matters. Now let us go and fight! Towards the sea. It is easier to restrain these things than the proud wrath of a nation. The shouts of a divided country attest to this truth. The voices echo through the mountains, some shouting Estolfo, others Segismundo. The main hall of this palace has been reduced to a scene of horror, a vulgar theater where an unknown fate stages a tragedy.
Sir, we must postpone all celebration. We must put an end to all the applause and all the festive pleasures which your generous hand promised me. For if this country, which I hope to rule, is resisting the obedience it owes me, it's because I must first earn it. Give me a strong, proud horse. I will take my men and descend on my rival like lightning and thunder.
It's no use fighting what is meant to be, because in trying to avoid the risk one meets it. Cruel law, awful truth, terrible horror. A man trying to escape danger runs into it. I myself have destroyed my country.
Great king, unless you try to prevent the commotion that has started amongst rivals and is spreading through the streets, you will soon find your kingdom drowned in a red wave of blood. The tragedy of sadness and misfortune is all around us. So great is the ruin of your empire, so severe the rage for blood that my eyes and ears are filled with terror. Each stone turns into a tomb, each flower into a grave, each soldier into a living skeleton. Even the sun prefers to be blind and the wind to be breathless than to witness such a sight.
All is war. I only wanted to protect the people.
Thank God I reached your feet alive. The people, like a blind, reckless monster, have broken into the tower and set it free. And being treated and honored like a king a second time, he promises to make heaven's prediction come true.
Give me a horse that I might defeat an ungrateful son. If the wisdom of science has failed me, then I must resort to my sword to defend my throne.
I know that all is war, but you must listen to me. Astolfo has discovered who I am, and it's obvious he's chosen to trample my honor. Because he continues to meet us today in the garden at night. I know that courage shouts from your chest to join this war, but you must help me. I need your help, and I can only rely on you. I have the key. I can show you how you can enter the garden at night and avenge me by his death.
It's true from the moment I met you that I was inclined to do for you all that was within my power. I tried to find the means to recover your lost honor, even if it meant killing Astolfo. An absurd notion indeed. Astolfo proved his goodwill when he intervened in my defense and endangered his own life. So how do you expect my grateful soul can cause the death of a man who saved my own life? How am I supposed to
divide my attitude towards you and my affection for him. How am I supposed to torn? I am torn between what I have given and what has been given to me.
I do not have to remind you that the man who gives will always excel the man who receives. I am asking you to give me back my honor, since giving is nobler than receiving.
I will not kill Astolfo and add blood and suffering to a country that has already fallen into the hands of misfortune. If you wish to take refuge from shame, there are other ways.
And what do you suggest I do? Enter a convent and devote myself to God? If you were my father, I might put up with the insult.
Then what do you intend to do? Then what do you intend to do?
Kill Astolfo.
Are you armed with such courage, even if you've never known your father?
Yes.
What compels you to do this?
My self-respect.
No, you must see Astolfo.
As someone who has trampled all over my being.
As your king and husband to Estrella.
That will never happen, God.
This is madness.
I know.
Then overcome it.
I can't.
Then you will lose.
I know.
Your life and honor.
I know this too.
What do you intend?
My death.
You're mistaking despair.
No, it's honor.
It's madness.
It's valor.
It's frenzy.
It's anger, rage.
Is there no other way?
No.
Who will help you?
Myself.
Think well. There has to be some other way.
Some other way to ruin myself.
And we're both ruined. It's all ruined.
Now I knew before you as a woman. fight by your side. 3 times I have appeared before you. As a man, as a woman, and now as a humble soul.
It's true that I'm dreaming, and I should be remembering. There's not enough room in dreams for memories. And how could this woman say she saw me and mention such vivid details of my dream? And it was reality. It wasn't a dream. Such confusion. How can I say my life is a dream? Are glories and dreams similar? Is fiction reality? Is reality a lie? Is there so little difference between them? What is seeing and tasting? Is it a lie or a truth? Rosaura is in my power. I adore her beauty. She's here by my side. Let love break every rule, even her trust in me. This is a dream. It has to be a dream. But let me dream of joy and pleasure before they turn into sorrows. No. No, I mustn't be driven by desire and temptation. Pleasure is a lovely flame that does not last forever. I must look to eternity. Rosaura has been dishonored. As a prince, I shall restore her name and honor. Sound alarms! Prepare for battle!
Sir!
But sir, you offer no reply to my plight. Doesn't my pain and anguish deserve a single word from you, your highness? How can you turn your back on
me? Rosaura, in order for me to be kind, I must be cruel to you now.
My lord, I don't understand.
I'd much rather answer with my actions.
My lord,
than with
what
my
is
words.
That supposed to
it's
be?
Better like this!
After all I have done, how can you leave me in such darkness? How can you turn your back on me?
I cannot look at your face now. I cannot look at your beauty if you want me to think of your honor. Prepare for battle!
Sir!
My lady, can I have a word with you?
Lady, where have you been?
Locked in a tower, playing cards and consulting the future. I wanted to know if I was going to die.
Why?
Because I know the truth about you. In fact, Codoro! What is that noise?
What can it be?
It's an armed squadron marching out of the palace to fight the army of Segismundo.
Then why am I standing here like a coward? I should be at his side when there's so much cruelty and violence all around us.
Long live both our liberty and our king! Let them both be part of life and let's be happy! As long as I don't get caught in the middle of this war, I'll just stand up to the side and watch the whole thing from here. This is a well-hidden, safe, and secure place, and since death can never find me here, here's to you, death.
Is there a more unfortunate king or mistreated father?
Your army has lost direction and order.
My lord, we're losing this war.
My lord, you must escape. Save your life.
The losers are the cowards who escape battle. The winners are the fighters who combat their enemy till the end. Let us fight the inhuman cruelty of a tyrannical son.
Your Highness?
Heavens!
Who is this poor soldier covered in blood?
I am an unlucky man who was trying to escape death, and instead ran into it. We always run into the thing we're escaping from. Go back. Go back if you're trying to escape death. There's more safety amidst the bullets than on this secluded mountain. No corner, no
place is safe from the force of destiny.
No corner or hidden place is safe from the force of destiny. Oh God, how well the words of this corpse describe our ignorance and error. How eloquent is the trail of blood that flows from the open mouth of his wound and teaches us that all our efforts are wasted when we try to resist a higher power. I tried to save my country, and instead I handed it over to evil and destruction.
It's true, we cannot escape death no matter where we hide. But a good Christian should never say there's no protection against the force of evil. A prudent man can conquer fate, my lord. You must escape danger and misfortune while you still can.
My lord, take his advice. I have hidden a horse behind a large rock. He's as fast as the wind. Take him and escape this place.
It's God's will that I die, and I want to meet death here. Face to face.
My lord, run!
Why should I run?
What will you do, my lord?
What has to be done? Take its revenge. Let the words of heaven be fulfilled at last.
Illustrious court, you have been the witness to such great events. Be attentive and listen to what your prince has to say. God has his mysterious alphabet, and all that has been written on the blue papers of heaven is not meant to deceive. The one who lies and betrays us is the man who misinterprets and makes wrong use of God's words. My father, here present, who feared my rage, tried to prevent my existence in the world. My blood is noble, and my nature gentle. He made me an animal, a human beast. My father wakes the beast because it threatens him. He stares at the point of his own sword because he fears his own strength. My father feels weak and helpless, knowing he can't restrain the arms of the sea. Hear me now, father! Even if my rage were that beast, my fury that sword, my wrath that unruly sea, fate can never be defeated by injustice and cruelty. For violence breeds resentment and revenge. Now look at him. Kneeling at his son's feet, his kingdom destroyed. He took all measures to prevent a prophecy that threatened him and failed.
I'm younger in age. Less wise, less brave than this king. And I wonder how I'm going to overcome that fate. Get up, father. Give me your hand. Life has shown you your mistakes. I humbly kneel before you. I'm at your mercy.
My son, you have proven your nobility and earned your place in this kingdom. You're a prince. You deserve a laurel crown and the royal palm branch of victory.
Long live Segismundo!
There are other victories I need to win. The most difficult one is to have victory over myself, my heart. For the moment, let us set in order the dreams that will soon fade like breath on a piece of glass. Astolfo, give your hand to Rosaura.
But, sir...
Give your hand to Rosaura.
But, your majesty...
It is a debt of honor you owe her.
It is true I owe her some obligation. But, my lord, she does not have her father's name. It would be improper for me to marry...
Rosaura is as noble as you are, Astolfo.
She doesn't even know who her father is.
I am her father. I am willing to prove she's my daughter with my sword in a duel.
I don't understand.
I didn't want to reveal who she was until she was properly married.
But I'll keep my word.
In that case, you'll be our queen, Estrella. Give us your hand.
I'm fortunate to gain such honor.
Calderon, you who have been so loyal to my father, come to my arms and let me embrace you.
How you've changed!
Why do you seem surprised? My teacher was nothing but a dream. Tomorrow, life will become dust, and love a breeze that passes unnoticed. Out in the world, no one is awake. No one. So let us dream. And if someone can't sleep, let them open their windows. So they can gaze at the moving skies and dream with open eyes. Let them listen to music so they can dream through that sweet sound that enters their soul. I've learned that human happiness passes like a dream. So we must learn to enjoy it before it fades away. And we must ask noble hearts to forgive us if we make mistakes.